You actually can become this replacement for people driving. It's good for the environment, it's good for efficiency, it's good for road congestion, and it's, you know, it's something that...
So actually, your real enemy is not the taxi companies. It's GM, it's Chrysler, it's all the big car manufacturers, right? You're basically saying, we're going to stop people buying your cars.
We want Uber drivers to buy their cars. We actually have deals with a lot of those companies where cars can get, where drivers can get cheap cars. Yeah.
So I think I saw that recently you launched, or Uber in certain cities has tried carpooling, right?
Yeah, that was today.
Uber Pool, right?
Yeah.
Uber Pool in San Francisco.
Yeah.
But in Beijing, you're calling it the people's car.
Renmin Yobu.
Renmin Yobu, yeah.
The people's
way to support Tongren Ma.
It's a service where you can... Actually, my Cantonese is better than my Mandarin.
Okay, well, answering Cantonese, the people are doing.
It's a service where anybody can be a driver. We do a background check. We make sure they have all the insurance. And it's a non-profit, not-for-profit kind of ride-sharing model where if you have a car, you can turn on the app and someone can get a ride.
So what you're saying here is I can be a private car owner.
Yeah.
What do? I just register for Uber?
You register, we do background check, we make sure you have full insurance, we do a driving, we check your driving history.
And then I can share my car with other people.
You can share your car, yeah.
Have you ever been on business to Korea?
Yes, I was there for a launch.
Many years ago, I used to go there on business, you get into a cab, and the cab would suddenly stop, and somebody else would get in the cab.
Sounds like a terrible experience.
Yeah. Well, especially when it's like, you know, past drinking hours.
Yeah.
And this whole idea is kind of took off there. So are you trying to recreate, I mean, I know Beijing, people complain about traffic, they complain about pollution. Is the idea that by doing carpooling, you're introducing a whole new way for people to use transport? Do you think this is going to take off?
Yeah, it's just creating another choice that we think is safer, actually safer when you're on the Uber platform than other options, and it's more accessible. It's just a cheap way to get on.
So, how does it feel to work for a company that's worth $18 billion?
The same as it felt to work for a company that's worth $200 million.
I mean, it's no difference.
Yeah, I mean, the difference is that people want to meet with us a lot more. That's great. It's a lot easier now to launch this business than it was when I was in London. But you know, our CEO still hasn't sold a single share of Uber. And no one at the entire company has, and no one internally talks about an IPO. It's really just external that we hear about it. Like, the company's really out to do something and to change the way the world gets around, and everyone's on a mission, and that's true.
So I have an idea for you. I saw that in you've launched Uber Boat. Right, well, where's Uber Boat in Chicago or somewhere with water?
We'll do that every now and then. I don't know.
So how about Uber Sampan?
I love it. Let's do it.
Then get to Cheung Chau, Peng Chau, Lantau, Uber Sampan.
Yeah, great.
So tell us a little bit about, I mean, so you have an app. There's a few people in this room who are building apps. If somebody wants to market an app, what do you recommend is the best way to market an app?
For us, what's worked, and I can only speak as someone who came to a company as the 35th employee, as opposed to like, you know, I feel like a lot of the hard work was done before I got there. But I mean, for us, we make it as easy as possible for our users to tell our story for us. And that is really where it all comes from. I was talking to a driver in LA who said that one out of every two people who get in his car call someone to say, hey, I'm in an Uber. And I'd much rather that instead of that they share with everyone that they can get $10 off the ride and that we get a ton of users. And it's just about delivering an experience people want to talk about, finding reasons that they can talk about you. Like, eventually people get sick of calling their friends to say they're in an Uber. So then we do Uber ice cream. So they can call their friends and say, I just pushed the button, I got ice cream in 3 minutes. And then we do Uber escapade. You know, we do all these things to get people talking.
So do people check in when they get into an Uber car? Do you see a lot of people getting excited and doing check-ins?
I've tried to on Foursquare, but I think someone has to be there first.
It has to be there.
Yeah.
So, and I saw that Uber is also going into, I mean, the ambitions seem pretty high, right? The idea of not just delivering people, but delivering products.
Yeah.
So this concept of rush.
Yeah.
Is this making Amazon, Jeff Bezos, is he shaking in his boots? Is he like, oh my god, there's an upstart that's going to take...
He's an investor.
My drones.
He's an investor, so yeah, it could be a good thing. But no, to be honest, we care about transportation. And these other ideas, I think, could be great, and they're all optionality, but our transportation business quadrupled in revenue year on year.
When you say transportation, you mean of human beings, right?
Our Uber, we're just doing people right now, except for the small business in New York, and revenues are doubling every 6 months. And the reason they're still doubling in our fourth year when we're already in 150 cities is because we're super, super focused on transport. I think there are all these other things that can happen when you build the network we're building, but transport, you know, the Hong Kong taxi industry alone is $3 billion. You know, so there's just so much to do here before I worry about how you get your files to their place next door.
So I was very curious because I saw that Tencent invested in one of your competitors, Lyft.
That was Alibaba.
Lyft, right? Yeah. Alibaba.
Yeah.
So are you being pitched at by the Chinese internet players? Are they saying, hey, I want a piece of that?
Yeah. When I was setting up our business in China, every Chinese company wanted to partner with Uber. And actually, Alipay, you can use Alipay to pay for your Uber rides. And Uber's the only app in the world where when you use Alipay, you do it on Uber's platform. Every other app, you had to
go to
Alipay. But with Uber, you can connect with Zhifubao in the Uber platform. And the reason they're doing that is because every big Chinese company wants to be global. And they see Uber as a fantastic partner in that. They don't care about our China business, but you name the company and they want to work with Uber right now.
That's very interesting. So the payment side, I think, is interesting. I saw that you're now starting to move away from individuals to companies. So I read that there's some kind of partnership going on between Amex, Concur. The idea of when you know, because everybody hates having taxi receipts, right? You lose them, whatever. Yeah. Then the ink disappears after 3 days.
Yeah, well, every Uber trip you have your receipt emailed from day one.
So what's the link of the business going to business? I saw Airbnb and you guys are going for the business market.
Yeah.
Well, what's this all about?
Well, I mean, the amazing thing about Uber, it blows me away, is that we've gotten as big as we are without a corporate product. I mean, people who are spending someone else's money are such a great target for someone like us. And we've built what we have without even going into that space. So naturally, we're getting bigger, we're getting some really, really good business development people, and we're making it a lot easier for companies to work with Uber. But that's not at the expense of the personal business at all.
So one of the things I noticed that Uber's also very proud of on your blog is you do a little data crunching.
Yeah.
You provide these really nice infographics about behavior and rush hour and stuff like that. Is there anything that you've seen, you know, just yourself in London or Amsterdam or Singapore that you just thought was interesting? Not you know, ultimately confidential, but stuff that's interesting from a usage. Because the data that you guys have, as far as I know, obviously you've got the trips that people take. You know the smartphone they use, right? Is it iOS? Is it Android? Is it Xiaomi? Whatever, right?
Yeah. Kind of back to your question about how you get good users is we get our best users from people who we give like $10 off their free offer first ride to.
How many people in this room got $100 free? There you go. We need to get more, man.
What we found though, so you have 100, and anyone here, Sam HK is a code for $100 off your first ride. A lot of Uber young marketing people want to give like 3 free rides and then we'll get them. Or want to give like 500 Hong Kong off their first ride and all that stuff. And we find if you take a first ride, then we got you. Then you're going to be a great customer. And one of the most amazing things about Uber, every internet company out there has churn, where in month 8, people are doing fewer transactions than month 3, and Uber has negative churn. So at Uber, our customers who've been at Uber for 8 months are doing far more trips than people who've been at Uber for 3 months. So for us, it's just...
This is universal across all the cities.
Our global statistics have this very negative churn where people just get more and more hooked. And I think, you know, what I found is like more in that initial promo period has nothing to do with how good our customers become. It's just actually want people paying at the beginning. If people pay at the beginning, they get used to paying. And then you get really, really good long-term customers who use you because you make their lives easier. That's one thing that I think has been, like, for me as someone who's launching the business, trying to do whatever I can to get people riding, to kind of like hold back a little bit and just let people experience it, let people tell their friends about it, let people enjoy the experience, and then you'll build the business, and forcing it hasn't helped.
But so I'm still curious about this data stuff. So share with us some of the kind of data that comes out that's not...
I'm trying to think.
I know it's hard.
We did a really interesting thing yesterday where we looked at like surge pricing and how higher prices influence people's decision about whether or not they book. And we found it wasn't as relevant as how close the nearest driver was.
So I can understand at 8 o'clock on Conduit Road, you're trying to get to work. Yeah. You don't care, you just want to get to work.
Yeah, and it was really looking at like how much that multiple impacts people's decision to book versus the proximity of the driver. The whole analysis was quite interesting. I'm not articulating it well because I don't know it well enough right now. But I thought that was like an interesting tip.
So another thing that I'm curious about is how, you know, in Hong Kong, a lot of foreign internet companies come here and they always target the expat or the, you know, returning Chinese, Canadian, CBC, ABC, all that stuff.
Yeah.
How do you get into the, you know, small business owner in Kowloon Bay who, you know, is still price conscious and whose cousin knows somebody who has a car? Or is that not your audience? I mean, I'm curious about how do you get into the very local Chinese?
Sure. I don't mean,
you know, the tram users. I mean, you know, wealthy or successful people. How do you get into that crowd?
You hire good people. I mean, like, you hire people who know them. You hire people who know how to market to them. It's the same in every city. You know, we only hire 3 people per city. So obviously you only have so many.
So who in this audience is working for you? Where's your good people?
We got one guy right here, Kenneth.
Let me see. So there's one of your 3, one of the elite.
We have 3. So Kenneth is our operations manager, and he does all the interacting with the drivers. You know, okay.
He knows where to go, what's the best cha tan king in
He knows that. We hired a guy named Justin, and he knows everything about the social scene in Hong Kong. And you know, maybe our next hire, when we think we need to get much more local, is going to be someone who's ingrained in that community. And those hires are, you know, I can't do it. Those hires are what make it work for you. And my job is to make sure they know how to become viral, how they know how to get a lot of leverage out of what.
So one question that I haven't asked is how do you make money?
We take 20% of every fare.
20%
of every trip.
It doesn't matter if it's a discount or not, you'll do 20%.
If your ride is $100, then we'll take 20%. If we gave it to you for free, then we'll give the driver 80, we take 20.
Normally a driver in Hong Kong, my understanding is they buy a license, or they rent the license, right? They basically have to pay the owner of the car, whatever it is, 250 Hong Kong a month a day, or 2,000 a day, whatever. And so they make the difference, is that right?
That's the taxi industry.
Yeah.
We work with limousine operators.
Okay.
So generally we're with people who own limousines, they have licenses for the limousines, and then we pay the fleet owner.
So what happens after Hong Kong? What's next? Macau?
We're already in 25 cities in Asia. I think Macau will be there at some point.
Bangkok? Are you in Bangkok?
Yeah.
Your Bangkok
is crazy. Yeah, it's an amazing market.
Interesting.
But basically anywhere you are in Asia right now, you can use Uber. There aren't that many cities that Hong Kong flies to where you can't get off the plane and use Uber.
Very nice. All right, let's open to some questions from the floor. So who has a question? We've got some prizes here later, but I think we'll leave these for the lucky draw. So let's take some questions from the floor. Who's got a question they want to ask? There must be some of you, because there's a really loud lot in the back. Could you come forward? Because the mic, I don't want to pass the microphone all the way down. Could you tell us who you are and who you work for?
I'm just graduating from Hong Kong University MBA program. I have one simple question. Recently there was news about how Uber has been banned in South Korea. It's proving to be a threat to the other public taxi services. What's your take on that? Because it's news article also says that this could sort of extend to other countries as well, as the government start to realize how it would be a threat to those
Sure. I mean, I think the question was how are we dealing with Korea, where the government issued a statement about how they didn't appreciate Uber. I think, look, we're entering a space where there is a status quo that's been in place for the past 50 years. And it hasn't really changed. Getting a taxi looks the same as it always has. And what Uber does is we come in and we bring choice to consumers. And we make it so riders can choose to take a taxi, they can choose Uber. We bring jobs to the driving community, but it shakes the status quo. And in just about every city we've been in, when we get to a certain size, there are people who really, really, really want to preserve the status quo and who don't want the choice and want to limit supply and give consumers less options. And we don't agree with it. And we think that consumers should have choices. We think drivers should be able to make money. And, you know, we haven't left a single city. No one's forced us out. They've said things like that, and that happens in a lot of places. But we're pretty staunch believers that what we're doing is good for cities, it's good for
society. So what you're saying is it's just a statement by the government, it's not a regulation.
Yeah, I mean, in Korea, we're still operating our businesses just as strong as it was before then. We think, you know, that Uber's really good for people in Seoul. I get emails from people in Korea all the time who say they love Uber. So it's pretty hard for us to say we're going to shut down because someone's trying to protect an industry that's been the same for 50 years.
I can understand that, because in Korea, taking a taxi is quite confusing as a foreigner, because there's the kind of luxury ones and the not so luxury ones, and the people jump in halfway ones.
Yeah, they got a lot of choice. And look, I like taxis in Korea. I think it's a good issue. We're just providing a different choice, and we're
okay. So we have a question from there's you lot in the back who are talking really loudly. You must have a question. You lot in the back talking loudly, lot rude. Rude lot, you got a question?
Yes.
Rude lot, rude. Are you part of the rude lot? Well, I can't see who's got. There you go.
Hi, and thanks for coming tonight. I'm over here because you said you don't look to your
left.
Hi, thanks. My name's Michael. I'm from First Page, an online marketing company. I just wanted to know the two easiest markets to crack from your knowledge and the two hardest.
Two easiest and the two hardest. I think, you know, Hong Kong's been an amazing market. It's the fastest growing market we've ever had outside of the U.S. So this, and it blew me away. I lived here for 6 years. I had the exact same questions about Hong Kong, but this has been an incredible market for us. Other markets, like the growth we're seeing in Ho Chi Minh City has been insane. The growth in Bangkok has been, like these numbers that we're turning out are just crazy. So. Bogota, Colombia, it's really random places where Uber just catches on like wildfire. What's been tough? You know, London was tough. London took a long time, and it was one of our first international cities, and it took a while. In Asia, yeah, Seoul. I mean, we prefer governments saying they like us. So that's certainly not been
Does Xi Jinping, does he like you? If you're so one thing I was going to ask you, I'm just curious about, is do you spend a lot of money on marketing? I mean, are you buying your own app, right?
Yeah.
So are you going nuts on Facebook, or are you buying, you know, through the mobile ad networks? You mentioned about the word of mouth stuff, right?
Yeah.
But are you spending a lot of money on the Facebook, the mobile install ad? Is that where you put your money?
No, we don't. Like in the US, we do a bit more, but here I upgraded our launch blog when we launched in Hong Kong, and I said to spend $400 thinking it was Hong Kong, but I spent $400 US. So I actually spent a decent amount on that launch post, but other than that, I don't think I've spent a single penny on advertising since I got here.
So as an app, do you believe in advertising through Facebook or, you know, Weibo or the app networks, Flurry, all those kind of guys?
Yeah, I mean, for us, it's tough, right? Because if you're going to sign up for Uber, you have to give us your credit card data. You know, you have to have people who, like, you can't even see the app unless you've given us your credit card. You know, so it's hard for someone to see an app on Facebook ads, click in, and then say, sure, I'm going to give you my credit card number. You know, so for us, it's the word of mouth stuff, the events where it's an event and you have a call to action is so much better for us because you just need those trusted sources to give your credit card number up.
But if people like PayPal and Facebook are starting to get credit card numbers,
Yeah. Can't
people just, is that another route to sign up? Is that another route that you see people doing? I mean, you're saying you're doing it with Alibaba, you're doing through...
Yeah, you can sign up with Google Wallet.
Yeah.
So I'm sure it's just going to get easier and easier with time as more people have their credit cards online. But you know, launching this in Amsterdam, there's just like 50% credit card penetration. So yeah, it's certainly, you know, we're hoping that people will start getting more credit cards, but that can be a very big...
Yeah, I mean, one of the things that you keep saying over and over again is how simple this whole thing is. I mean, you have three people in Hong Kong, no marketing, I mean, it's an app, I mean, you know, it's elegantly simple, right? But, so, and maybe this is a question for Napoleon as well. I mean, why can't Hong Kong startups come up with an app? Or what do you say, is it a halo effect from the U.S. and it's Uber? Or maybe there are a bunch of apps that you find from city to city, but they just never quite took off? I mean, why wouldn't somebody now kick out what city you aren't at yet and go, okay, let's go on to Uber there in Chengdu or something, right?
Before you answer, I heard somebody in the back going, we've got that! Who is that?
Yeah.
She's going to do a slight disruption.
No, I was just going to say that I love Uber in London. I use it a lot, so I live here now. And when I try to use Uber here, it hasn't been very successful. So I wonder if you're going to a slightly more upmarket market than the London market, which covers the whole breadth. But we have Easy Taxi here, and it's excellent.
Yeah.
It's genuinely excellent. I use it every day, and I get a taxi call up within 2 minutes when Uber never picks up. So. Mm-hmm. I think we've done it well. Okay, it's a VC also invested. It's not Hong Kong born and bred, but it's a very good app.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, it's part of the Rocket, the infamous Rocket VC group,
yeah.
who copy.
I'm the one who responds to customer complaints. I know that, I can tell you that the complaints we get now are nothing compared to what we got in London when we were 5 weeks in there. I mean, we've been in Hong Kong for 5 weeks. Actually, it's 7 weeks now, and if you look at our numbers, it's growing faster, and we have more reliability than we've had in any city in history after 7 weeks. It's just London we've been in for 2 years. I think that Hong Kong's going to get there, and I think that we are going to be the go-to shop where you push a button and get a ride. Other people can do it, but I think, I don't have a whole lot to say about that experience. I just know there's something about the network effect where we have a lot of users. We have a lot of drivers, and it just takes time, but Hong Kong will be as good as London was. I've seen both when they were 7 weeks in, and London didn't even compare to what we're doing here. So I'm pretty confident in the business here, and stick with us. We'll give you discounts and make sure it works.
So Mike, my theory is, in Hong Kong there are some, actually Yan, where's Yan? Are you here, Yan? Yan is in Shenzhen, right? He runs Startup Grind in Shenzhen. He was telling me, showing me this app that has gone like wildfire in Hong Kong. What's it called again?
MYOT.
So who in this room is using MYOT? This is a kind of make your own avatar. You're not? Well, you should do. So something like that, right, takes off really rapidly without any advertising, goes on Facebook, people start seeing their avatars change, the office talk goes, and it spreads, right? So, I think there are local ones here, but they don't have that kind of PR thing going on that you get at Ubers or at the Halo, yeah. And there's a lot of companies here that start off gaming world. I mean, WeChat, when they first launched in Hong Kong, were doing very little marketing. But, of course, then they started, covering the trams and getting... But there was a lot of noise eventually around WeChat, but they took off really, really rapidly. But I don't know, with Uber it seems to me that you get a lot of people from overseas who come here, they experience it somewhere else. And because Hong Kong is such a transient city, you get a lot of people who've experienced it somewhere else and they want to try it here.
We get a lot of global users, but our busiest hour of the day is 8 a.m. And that's people on Conduit Road and Robinson Road, and people who just want to use Uber to get to work. And our busiest hour is 7 p.m. on a Friday, and that's people going home from work. And like our business here is becoming local. Very, very quickly. But yes, it certainly has a bit of adrenaline from the fact that it's such a global city.
So you've basically got an easy job. Just go to a new city and say, like, Uber's here, hello. And it happens.
It's getting easier.
Hire three people and it happens. But here, well, let's take one more question and then we'll do a little lucky draw.
Hi, it's Charlton Stevens, volunteer at State University. I was wondering, when you hear all these demands, especially in Europe but in other countries, for protectionism on behalf of licensed taxi drivers, how do you respond to the issue of like taxi licensing specifically? And could you ever conceive of having some kind of collaboration with the government to license Uber cars?
Yeah, I think it's a good question. Uber cars, take London, for example, where the strike was. Uber cars are licensed. There is a licensed limousine industry, and there's a licensed hire car. They're called minicabs, and they're legal. In Hong Kong, we're working with licensed limousine operators. So there is a licensed industry, which
was generally reserved for CEOs and for hotel guests, and we're just making that available to everyone. Yeah, so the business is with license. I mean, in London, what they were complaining about.
Yeah, but in Japan, you're a travel agency.
I mean, the issues with London, if I read it right, were that you don't know the fare before you get in, which was, you know, we just give you a fare estimate, but it's not set in stone. And the reason that rule exists is because you used to get into a car, and then the driver would take you all around, and then they needed some way to protect the consumer from getting ripped off. Now, Uber, we give you a map that shows the exact route and refund if you get in any way taken the wrong route. So we've already solved that. But because we give a fare estimate instead of a, you know, that stuff is small. But we're working with licensed operators. So I think there's a bit of misunderstanding about what they're actually upset about.
Okay, so I think we'll end it there. A round of applause for Sam. He's done a great job. Thank you very much. If you put your name card at the front, we're now going to do a lucky draw.
And what do they get?
They get
Annette. Can I have the name cards? Annette! Can somebody go and get the name cards from the girl at the door, please? Annette! So what are we giving away?
A charger, a Lux guy,
an Uber power bank. Not for your car.
Yes, and we're doing $500 of credit for the grand prize.
A guide to Hong Kong brought to you by Uber. Nice. And what's this?
That's a USB.
A USB, all right? So we're going to do, for those of you who left your name cards, we're going to do a little lucky draw. And the top prize will be 500 Hong Kong dollar credit, right?
Yes.
Can I have a name card? There you go. Annette, stay here. So, alright, Sam, over to you, man.
Oh, no, I get to pick.
You get to pick. You can come down, you come in. Ready? And the winner is Silence Drumroll.
Jardine Nightclubs. Yeah, I like the Netherlands. Jardine, been here.
Are you here?
Jardine, so. Jardine. Yeah, you met the native longer, though.
Are you here? Ah, there you go. Yeah. Excellent. Little photo session.
Thank you.
Got a couple of photo characters. Let's photo a little photo. Excellent. Are you from Amsterdam?
Close.
Oh, yeah, right. Excellent. Thank you. Nice. Thank you. All right, next one. Eyes closed.
All right. We have Regulation Asia, Brad McLean.
Regulation Asia. Sounds like the guys you want to make friends with.
Yeah, I can't tell if this is a good
Regulation guy. Asia, are you here? Going once, Regulation Asia. Going twice,
Brad McLean.
Brad McLean, Regulation. You're getting deregulated. Come on. Next one. Didn't want to hear the finish.
Raymond Yip.
Raymond Yip.
From Shopline.
Raymond Yip. You were here earlier, I saw you. Raymond Yip. Where are you?
From where?
Shopline. Shopline, Raymond Yip. Raymond, going once.
I think we got him back over.
Raymond, going twice. I can hear somebody clapping. Does that mean it's you? Raymond Yip. Yeah, well, Raymond Yip. Go on. Hi, Dean. All right, Raymond Yip. No, sorry. He's dead.
All right. Now we got Jason Liu from Atlas.
Jason, yeah. Is that? There we go. Excellent. Photo. Get your own bag. Hi, right, little photo. Okay.
And it's just the grand prize.
The grand prize, close your eyes. What is the grand prize?
$500 in liquid credit.
Okay. To use in one go.
Wow, this is exactly like Brent Deverman.
Brent Deverman.
Brent,
Shenzhen Party Man, where are you? Brent. Brent, go once.
Alright, here we go.
Here's your opportunity to take an Uber all the way back to Shenzhen. Alright, thank you very much everybody. You're welcome to stay here till 9:30. Get to know each other. We'll see you again here on the 17th of September. Okay, thank you.